All right, the regular season's over, but the fun's just beginning here on Lions Talk Live. Today, we're going to throw at you our Mock Draft 1.0. We're going to start getting ready for the biggest event of the offseason, which is in just 2 months. That is the NFL Draft. So, tune in, get ready to sit down, grab your Mountain Dew, coffee, or whatever, and we'll talk about drafts, maybe some trades, maybe just a little bit more. In today's first run edition of our Mock Drafts, in today's Lions Talk Live. Well, greetings and salutations to everybody out there in YouTube land. I'm your host once again, Dan Thornton. I want to thank each and every one of you for tuning in today, Friday, to see what we're talking about here on Lions Talk Live. If you haven't yet subscribed, please consider doing so. It takes you a second, maybe a second and a half, to hit that subscription button. Thumbs up button, and if you want to, maybe even leave some thoughts in the comments section below. But here we're going to get into Mock Draft 1.0. We'll try to do this from time to time now leading into the actual draft to see where things are shaking, where they're changing, you know, what kind of updates do we have as we get closer and closer to the draft. And teams, even though they play things very tight to the vest, they may give some indications if they're leaning in this direction or that direction. Also, how is free agency going to affect our teams? Ability to draft, what we're going to target, things of that sort. So a lot of things are going to be coming at us over the next couple of weeks. Obviously, the free agency period is just, we'll say 6 weeks away or so, and that will have a huge impact. That will also tell us all as fans, what are we really trying to target in the draft. But now, enough of the jibber-jabber. Let's get into our first pick in the mock draft for 2023. So let's start off by just a real brief recap. We understand that the Lions have the number 6 overall pick because the LA Rams took the biggest nosedive by defending Super Bowl champions ever. And that was Detroit's good fortune. We also know that we have a general manager who loves to get great value while trying to produce future results. So with that being said, the Atlanta Falcons step up and offer the Detroit Lions the number 8 overall pick, the number 44 overall pick in this year's draft. And then they spice it up a little bit more knowing Detroit has other phone calls from teams. They also give Detroit Lions the 2024 first overall pick. Lions look at all the other offers out there because they are in one of the greatest positions in all the draft. And the number 6 pick, you don't have to incredibly pay. But when they watch the draft board, the 5 people going off before, a number of teams are intrigued for this player, that player, seeing how they can change their fortunes. And if you're a general manager or coach trying to get to a second contract, you need the fan base to rally around you. So Brad Holmes milks all the teams he can, and he finds that the Atlanta offer is indeed the best offer. So just a brief recap. We get the number 8 pick, number 44 pick, and Atlanta's 2024 first round pick. So now we find the Detroit Lions at the number 8 overall pick. They moved down 2 spots. They got an additional second rounder. Yes, they did have to swap one of their second rounders up, but I'm not going to get into all the details. I'll try to put it in the graphics behind us just to keep this video moving along. But what do we know about the NFL? Everybody needs a quarterback. Everybody needs something. And at draft day, sometimes people make irrational decisions. We find that to be the case with, in my opinion at least, the number 6 pick trading down to number 8. But Brad Holmes' phone rings again. He's got a number of offers, a lot of them tempting. Brad Holmes knows ultimately what he wants to target in this draft, and he feels, instead of trading up like he did last year, he has an opportunity a second time to trade down in this year's draft and still gain more capital to help build his team. So what's he do? He gets a call from the Steelers. Steelers offer him the number 17 pick, number 32 pick, and number 49. I just want to make sure I check my notes to have it right. Brad Holmes looks at 2 other offers from other teams, and he says, you know what? We're going to take this one. So Brad Holmes now has gained multiple picks, and some even next year, in order to just move down from number 6 to 8, and now from number 8 to 17. So here we are in the draft, and what do we know the Lions are going to target? It was perceived coming into the draft. They're going to target fixing this defense. They're going to target adding some depth to key positions on both sides of the ball. And because of all the trades, the Lions now have a lot of ammunition to throw around. So Lions at number 17 target a 6'1", uber-fast cornerback from South Carolina. That's right, Cam Smith. They send up the card, they draft him, and what the Lions have now done, they've shown the first signs towards what they're trying to do. Aaron Glenn is going to be sticking around, it would appear, based on this draft scenario. He's going to be the man running the defense for Detroit Lions for a third straight year. And I'm sure as all Lions fans understand, he loves to play man-to-man and match up and give you no easy holes to throw into. So what have they done with this first pick? They've picked up an exceptional, fast, and physical tall cornerback who excels at man-to-man. Also, we're going to pay attention to one other thing. He has an alpha personality type or driver personality, depending on what board you metrics your terminology on. But somebody who's a leader, somebody who's physical, and somebody who wants to go out there to succeed. These are key components to me if you're paying attention to draft board. You want to understand the person's internal personality as well as their physical attributes. So Smith's senior season was an exceptional one as he batted down 5 passes, picked off 1, and had 32 solo tackles. If you watch his hips, you watch his feet, and watch his playmaking ability, all these are exceptional areas for Lions to build around. Lions like to play a lot of press coverage. They also at times back off in their man-to-man principles. They don't do the same thing all the time, but what we can say about Smith is he excels at both of these. And the most important thing for a man-to-man corner is, does he have that person have makeup speed? If the receiver beats the jam, can they close the gap between the two? And this guy can, and he does it incredibly well. Well, as I'm sure you're all knowing, the Lions didn't have to wait long for the next pick, but what do you know? Brad Holmes, the man who shows he loves to make a deal, wheel and deal and trying to get better results, he gets a number of calls. A lot of people have interest in a number of players still on the draft board. He gets a couple offers that seem very tempting, but this time Brad Holmes turns it down. He wants to go with the player he really covets for his team. Cam Smith was a great one, but he understands he needs to still build on this D in order for this team to really go to the next level in 2023. So Christian Gonzalez's name is sent up to the board, and the Lions draft a second straight corner. Much like the first one in Cam Smith, this guy can play press man coverage. He has incredible speed, and he's 6'2", about roughly 15 pounds heavier than Cam Smith. But Gonzalez, let me tell you, now gives the Lions two guys that are young, rookie contracts, lengthy, that excel at man-to-man principles. Much like Smith, one of Gonzalez's best strengths is that once he presses and the receiver releases on him, he can make up distances incredibly quick. The Lions are showing to everybody in the NFC, and then more importantly, the NFC North, they're going to come after you, and they've got guys in the secondary to back them up. Gonzalez is long, lengthy, incredible speed, as we already talked about. His senior season, he batted down 7 passes, picked off 4, and had 38 solo tackles. The guy is somebody who can help out run support, something I will say I think Cam Smith is going to have to develop a little bit more in his game. But both of them seem to fit the mold that the Lions prefer to have. Now, where the secondary was kind of iffy a year ago, you're starting to see some real depth. Can they salvage Jeff Okuda? Waits to be seen. But what we do know is all of a sudden there's incredible depth and value at this position. Both these gentlemen will be on rookie contracts for the foreseeable future, and that gives the Lions and the general manager a lot of ammunition to throw around at other spots, potentially in free agency in 2023 or 2024. The Lions, yes, they do want to try to address the defensive line, and everybody's probably jumping up and down looking at this mock draft saying, man, we got to get a defensive tackle. And that could be a segue into the Lions' next move. The Lions definitely show with this draft that they're focused on changing this defense, making it better, putting upgrades across the board. And thanks in large to that draft trade earlier in the day with the Steelers, the Lions find themselves in a advantageous position. They have the number 32 pick. They've already added 2 very good quality corners that are excelling man-to-man principles, but now they want to get a little bit more out of that defensive line. They want to put a little bit more pressure on other quarterbacks. So what do? They race up to the table with a ticket saying, hey, this guy's still on the board. We're going to snag him at number 32. And that's Brian Breesy from Clemson, a sophomore, 305, 310-pound kid who has shown throughout his prior season in 2022 that this kid's got a lot of potential, upside, width, girth, arm length, etc. He's got tons of upside potential. He had 3.5 sacks, and he does get good pressure off the ball. Not only that, he is very sound at helping out in the run game. So the Lions have addressed 3 spots of major concern all late in the first round based on those 2 first trades early in the day. The Lions are starting to show some real promise, some real upside, and they still got a lot of ammunition left. Breezy at 6'5" also gives them another big body throw in there. Lions have got Bugs and obviously Lee McNeil. But one of the things we like most when we're viewing Breezy is the fact that he's already got an upside over most defensive tackles coming out of the draft with his understanding of hand placement and how to shed blocks quickly from offensive linemen. While he might not have been the number one defensive tackle on the board, I think everybody gets it, that's Carter. But the Lions were able to achieve getting 3 guys of immediate assistance on this defense by pulling off those 2 trades with teams that found themselves overpaying to get something they need. And again, like we said, I think part of that is those general managers are going to feel pressure to win now. That means they need to get key pieces on their field to keep their owners and fan bases happy. But it also means they make illogical, irrational decisions. In my opinion, same thing as the LA Rams and Sean McVay did just 2 years ago. And Brad Holmes is more than willing to assist them in overpaying. That has led to this basically being a home run day for the Lions, with the first 32 picks off the board and the Lions potentially having 3 starters right off the bat. All right, let's remember that we made a couple of key trades at the start of the day early in the first round that showed benefits for us. Yes, we had moved down from number 6, number 8 to number 17, etc., but we were able to pick up a number of secondary picks that may be proving to be advantageous for everybody in the Detroit Lions fan base. The next up is pick 44, which we got in the Atlanta trade. And now, what do we use it on? Well, we didn't get the best running back on the draft board, but we might have got someone nearly as good. And I'm going to probably murder this name when I say it, Jahmyr Gibbs, a running back from Alabama. And I apologize if I did mispronounce the name, but I haven't heard it yet, so I'm just going to say this. This is where I picked. I found him to be incredibly explosive, a lot of versatility, similar in many facets to DeAndre Swift. So if the Lions are looking to eventually move on from Swift and potentially even Jamal Williams in the future, they're going to have to start addressing the running back depth charts. This kid was nearly a 1,000-yard rusher, averaged about 6.1 yards a carry this year. So he's got a ton of potential. He's got home run hitting abilities, and he's been very, very versatile for Alabama. I think it would be an excellent pick for the Lions to start addressing a couple of things in the offensive side of the ball. So Gibbs was the number 44 overall pick, and the Lions find they only have to wait a few minutes to have the next pick. At pick 49, the Lions are going to target adding a potential starter slash, if nothing else, some depth during his first year, and that's going to be Darnell Wright from Tennessee. 6'6", 6'7", 335-pound offensive lineman. Yes, they will have to probably move him to guard. He played tackle, but let's look back. In his career, he did play some time at guard. So is it something he's already familiar with? Yes. Is it something he's specialized at? No. But I do believe the Lions are going to make some changes to some of the personnel on the offensive line. You're going to have an opportunity here to get younger, bigger, more physical, and save on salary cap. Something all teams constantly are having to fight and juggle. Let's not try to deny it. But this kid's mean. He's nasty. He's got an intuitive personality traits. He's got a lot of positives that I like about it. Doing a deep dive on him, I haven't done that. But from what I did study yesterday, trying to get ready for this video, I'm going to say this. This kid's got a nasty streak in him. And if the Lions can put him in, say, at right guard, well, Evan Brown's a free agent. And he's probably not returning, so you're going to have to cut his salary and add this kid. Just a bit of a recap real quick before we keep going on down the draft chart. You've added potentially a starting offensive lineman. And whether or not he's starting this year or next year, let's wait and see. But you got bigger and more physical there. The run game, which I like Evan Brown. I think he's an incredibly gifted offensive lineman. I do not think playing guard is his strength, nor run blocking. Pass blocking, that's different. I think he's incredible there. But they did move him from center to guard, and you know, some of that's out of necessity, but he is a free agent right now, so somebody's going to come after him and offer him a pretty good amount of money. It'd be my opinion that adding somebody like Wright is going to help alleviate that financial burden. We've also added a running back. You know, yes, we've got some depth here at running back, but let's be fair. You're going to have to make choices with some of these guys. Who are you going to pay and who are you going to keep? You've added two starting corners, both of them with speed, both of them physical, and both of them can make plays on the ball. And you've also offered to your defensive coordinator, potentially a starting defensive tackle to go next to McNeil. If nothing else, you've added some very good quality depth there. Now, let's keep going on with the draft. All right, I'm going to speed through the rest here since this video is getting a little lengthy. Third round, I do have the Lions making a trade. They do pick up a fourth and a seventh this year. They do also add a seventh and sixth next year with New Orleans. But with that being said, really from here on out, they're adding depth. I do have them picking up two linebackers. I do have some getting also a quarterback to develop, the TCU quarterback, Max Duggins. So from here on out, I think at this point in the draft, everything they're getting is going to be more depth-based. It's not going to be like the last few years where there was just such little talent on the team that you had a realistic chance, if you were a decent rookie, to step in and get minutes right away. Or now the Lions, at most positions, have some legitimate talent. Receivers, it's going to be hard for anybody drafted to come on in and do something unless they're just off the charts. Same with quarterback, you know, running back, offensive line, throughout the defense. But I do think the one thing the Lions did here that we noted in this video is they addressed the secondary. They added, you know, some depth at defensive line and offensive line. Some real nice players there as well. Linebackers are going to take more chances on. And yes, we are going to address the quarterback position to try to get somebody young to develop and be a legitimate backup, but also at a salary cap number that's friendly. All right, well, that's going to do it for the video. What did you think of Mock 1.0 from Lions Talk Live? We're able to add a lot of good parts, in my opinion, plus add, looks like, about 3 or 4 picks for next year's draft. Nothing that you can sneeze at. So let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. If you haven't yet subscribed to Lions Talk Live, please consider doing so. Like I said before, it takes about a second, maybe a second and a half, to hit the subscription button, leave a thumbs up, and again, if you want, leave some comments in the notes below. Take care, enjoy your day, and we will have another Lions Talk Live available for you tomorrow, a special one on Saturday. So hope you all enjoy your day, and we'll see you tomorrow on Lions Talk Live.